Hello, I'm Dr. Steve Kopecky, a preventive cardiologist at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. We're continuing on with our Interviews with the Experts prevention segment. And today it's my pleasure to introduce Ms. Lisa Gilman, who's one of our very experienced nurse practitioners. She's done inpatient, outpatient practice, sees patients every day. That Lisa, I understand almost half the patients now are on supplements. Is that your experience? It's quite prevalent now.
Yes, yes. We see that a lot. A lot of questions about that.
Yes. So this is a great subject today. We'll talk about some of the supplements that many of our patients are reading about and taking and asking about. So Lisa, many of our patients will ask if there are any supplements that will help lower their cardiovascular event rate or help their heart health. How do you approach this topic overall?
Yeah, that's a good question, Dr. Kopecky. Supplements are often inquired about by our patients as sometimes they're considered a more natural or safer way to prevent cardiovascular disease in hopes to avoid medical therapy where there may be a concern of side effects. Overall, there's a lack of beneficial evidence in supplement use, but still our patients are using them. It's estimated that more than $12 billion are spent annually on supplements. And it's important not to dismiss the patient, but to have a shared decision-making discussion to ensure safety, potential efficacy, and cost considerations when considering benefits and risks. There are a few supplements that may have some benefit.
What supplements really have been shown to help our cardiovascular health?
Yeah. The supplements I'm going to discuss today are just a sampling of what's been marketed for cardiovascular health. Most of the supplements of benefit surround optimizing cholesterol, given that hyperlipidemia is a major risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Plant stanols and sterols are products that help interfere with absorption of cholesterol through the intestine. They are found in various food products, snacks, margarine spreads, vitamins, and chews. Because of their effect on the gastrointestinal tract, a common side effect is diarrhea. Red yeast rice is another product that is fermented with a particular kind of yeast. It contains a compound called monacolin K, which is the same substance as low-dose lovastatin. It inhibits HMG coreductase in the liver, thus lowers total and LDL cholesterol. The potential side effects are similar to statin therapy, including myalgias, and it can affect the liver. The overall concern is that there are variations of monacolin K levels from within different brands, so thus clinicians generally do not recommend it. Niacin, or nicotinic acid, has been used for lowering LDL and triglyceride levels. Niacin was approved previously by the FDA in 1997 for secondary prevention, particularly given its effect on raising the HDL. However, this approval was later withdrawn given subsequent large clinical trials that have raised concerns about its overall lack of cardiovascular health benefits, and that raising HDL with niacin does not equate to reduced cardiovascular events. Potential side effects include flushing and itching and can affect liver enzymes. There are niacin products that do not cause flushing, but they are not effective in lowering cholesterol. Yeah, another couple ones are berberine and citrus bergamot. Berberine is a traditional Chinese herb that's a weak PCSK9 inhibitor, which helps lower LDL cholesterol. It's important to be cautious of drug interactions with certain medications such as cyclosporin and other antihypertensive and diabetic medications. It's generally well tolerated, although side effects are primarily gastrointestinal. Again, like other supplements, there are no studies on benefiting cardiovascular outcomes. Citrus bergamot is another supplement also used to help lower LDL cholesterol and triglycerides. It's well tolerated and no significant drug interactions, but with this use, there's only mild to moderate improvements seen in cholesterol levels. So while eating fish is good for heart health and part of the Mediterranean diet, over-the-counter fish oil supplements have not been shown to reduce cardiovascular events. The best way to manage triglyceride elevations is to follow a heart-healthy diet while limiting saturated fats and refined carbohydrates and staying physically active. If over-the-counter fish oils are used for management of triglyceride elevations, there are two main forms of omega-3 to look for, which include EPA and DHA ingredients. It's important to note that fish oil supplements may contain large amounts of saturated fats or fillers, which could raise the LDL. So a common side effect of the fish oil can be fish burps, but one way to potentially help this side effect is to keep it in the refrigerator or freezer, which helps the product dissolve lower in the GI tract. I'll also note as an aside that prescription fish oil is available for managing severe hypertriglyceridemia for a select group of patients, and that includes Vascepa, which contains EPA formulation, as well as omega-3 acid ethyl esters, which is known as Lovaza, which contains both. Just be aware of potential side effects like antiplatelet effects and also the rare side effects of atrial fibrillation. Garlic is another one that's been marketed to help cardiovascular health, but there's been some reports that can be helpful in lowering blood pressure and some variable benefit in lowering cholesterol. It's kind of interesting. It's thought that the beneficial effects of garlic occur when the bulb is crushed, and that changes allin converted to allicin, which is why the fun fact is that, you know, it's always advised to crush your garlic first before you chop it up. Mm-hmm. But common side effects include bad breath, body odor, and rare incidents of bleeding because of antiplatelet activity. And the last one I'll mention is ground flaxseed. That's been also advertised. It can reduce some LDL cholesterol, but can also cause some GI side effects, gas and bloating, and may interact with some other medications. Dr. Kopecky, are there other ones that you find that you use in your practice?
Well, you know, one thing, that's a great rendition and summary of the supplements. Thank you, Lisa. The you know, one thing that our patients take a lot is a coenzyme Q10. And, you know, the big studies, I mean, observational studies have shown it reduces cardiovascular events. I'm not sure if it's reducing events because they're also on a statin, because the coenzyme Q10, specifically ubiquinol, ends in OL, is better absorbed. They take that to counter the side effects of the statin. A folic acid does seem to be a little beneficial in reducing stroke, especially if you have a high homocysteine level. In general, we don't recommend that for heart, however. You know, the omega-3s you mentioned, I think the EPA has probably been shown to be better, as you said, with the icosapent ethyl. And there's starting to be a lot of generic EPAs that are coming out now that we tend to have them take. And then finally, there's the, you know, the cocoa flavanols, which are, you know, chocolate, dark chocolate. And that does seem to have benefit, but I encourage patients, just eat the chocolate. Don't take some supplement. The chocolate's a lot more fun to take. So that's a great, great rendition. Thank you. And now many of our patients, Alicia, as you know, will ask us, gee, how do I know which one to take? Because there are a lot of supplements, as you mentioned, that have other things in them that may not help us and may actually hurt us. What do you tell them to do?
That's right. So although the FDA does not regulate the quality of supplements, of course, there are three national organizations which do testing on supplements, so they may be a little bit more reliable. Those include the National Sanitation Foundation. So you look on the label, it says NSF. The other one is U.S. Pharmacopeia, and that's labeled USP. And the other one is Consumer Labs, and that is labeled with a CL. It's kind of a picture of a test tube on there. Thus, if one of these are listed on the bottle, likely the supplement's of better quality.
Oh, that's great advice. So, and those things are inspected, and they're actually, most of them are from the United States, plants that make them, or factories that make those supplements. That's great advice. Any other final recommendations or considerations that you tell patients or that we should tell our audience about?
Absolutely. It is important to emphasize to our patients that no supplement can replace the benefit of good, healthy diet and exercise regimen. Additionally, if a patient is thinking of using a supplement, make sure that they inform their healthcare provider to ensure there will not be any interactions with their other medications they're taking or within their own health condition.
Great advice. And also, please tell your provider. Providers ask the patients about what they are taking, and it's really important. That's really almost the number one cause now of elevated liver function tests that we sometimes blame statins for. And it's really the supplements they're taking, like you mentioned earlier, that they are on. And I think that's the best advice you gave, Lisa, which is there is no pill that replaces a lifestyle. And that is so important. We've seen that in prescription meds, even with statins. You know, if you don't have a good lifestyle, even though it may lower your LDL, it doesn't reduce your event rate as much as having a good lifestyle.
Absolutely.
So, Ms. Lisa Gilman, thank you so much for joining us today and talking to us about supplements. It was really very informative.
Thank you, Dr. Kopecky. Pleasure to be here.